Thank you, Mike, for the introduction, and thank you for inviting me. Good morning, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here. Good morning. Today, I'm going to tell you why it is so important to teach young people to think globally. I'm going to show you that the future of young people looks very uncertain and gloomy, because the 21st century is unfortunately associated with an array of pressing global issues, frightening issues, issues that affect all of us. But I will also share hope, because a global crisis often brings opportunity. It brings communities together, like us here. And you and me, faith communities, nonprofits, NGOs, businesses, together we can make a real positive change on a global scale. But let's start with the planet, planet Earth, our home planet. We share this beautiful planet, the only planet in our solar system that we know of that can support an incredible variety and diversity of life. And at the start of life, humanity has had a symbiotic relationship with the Earth. However, in the 21st century, the planet systems bear the mark of our presence. We live now on a human-dominated planet. We are the drivers of change, putting immense pressure on Earth life support systems. In fact, we are literally eating it away at a rate unprecedented in Earth history. And scientists have argued that we have entered a new era, the Anthropocene. And that began when human activity had a significant impact on Earth ecosystems. And the scientific evidence is overwhelming. The last 65 years, so since the 50s and 60s, we have seen that the ecosystems that really matter to us have undergone profound transformation. Climate systems has experienced major disruption due to human activity. Global carbon dioxide emissions have increased since the pre-industrial era. And you can see since the 50s, it has experienced great acceleration. And their effects have been detected throughout the climate system. Oceans have warmed, ocean acidification has increased, the amount of snow and ice have diminished, and sea level has risen. And we no longer have to read about climate change in scientific journals. Evidence of the climate change crisis is unfolding before our eyes. Long periods of droughts, heat waves, heavy rain, these erratic weather patterns are very common these days. And there's also this issue of inequality, because climate change is mainly caused by wealthy nations like the US and the Netherlands, because of our unsustainable lifestyles. However, poor countries who less contributed to climate change are hit first and hardest, and they have little resources to adapt to the impacts of climate change. We are seriously disrupting the ocean ecosystems by over-exploitation of fish stock and marine life. And as you can see here, there's been a sharp increase in fisheries and aquaculture production since the 50s. And as a result, nearly 85% of the global fish stock is over-exploited. Species extinction numbers have sharply risen since the 50s. And a biodiversity crisis means that our health and livelihoods are at risk too. Deforestation is happening at an alarming rate due to the demand for food, for fuel, for fiber. In the US, only 4% of the original forest is left. And again, you can see there is a sharp increase in the 50s. And this happened simultaneously with a sharp increase in population growth, the so-called baby boomers. And the key driving force of all these global pressing problems is global capitalism. Because our current economic models our policies, they are designed to increase economic growth. Our goal is to increase gross domestic product, GDP, so that we can build more airports, more roads, more factories, more shops. And we all hear from our current leaders, we read it in the papers, we hear it on the news, that we are all winners of economic growth. So, in the US, we love to go shopping. We love to buy stuff. The more, the better. The bigger, the better. So we buy cars, we buy bigger cars, we buy new houses, bigger houses. We want a phone every year. Do we need it? Probably not. But the conventional economic system tells us that economic growth, an increase in GDP, is good for humanity. We are all winners. So, let's look at some facts of the US culture of excessive consumption. The US consumes 30% of planet's resources and creates 30% of planet's waste. Over 4 million pounds of toxic chemicals are released into air, water, and lands by industries each year. 3/4 of the households in the US use pesticides in their homes, gardens, and yards. Pesticides. Most pesticides are really bad for the land. It pollutes our soil. It kills our birds. But moreover, and a lot of people don't know that it is also killing our bees. And bees are responsible for 1/3 of the world's food production. 99% of the products produced are disposed of within 6 months. And each person in the US makes 4.5 pounds of garbage each day. We consume every day 500 million straws. So that's 1.6 straw per person. And you can fill 127 school buses with straws every day with plastic. So the conclusion is that we produce and consume far too much stuff. Stuff that is not always good for our planet. In fact, right now we consume more resources each year than that the Earth can replenish. So, the global ecological footprint, which measures human demand on planet's resources, has crossed the line, the boundary of one Earth. We need right now the equivalent of 1.5 planets to provide the resources we currently use and absorb the waste we have generated. Our current lifestyles are unsustainable. And it's happening right now. This reality is unprecedented in its global scale and speed, and it poses a serious threat to the resilience of Earth and human development. And it really suggests that we need to alter our relationship with the Earth fundamentally. Because there is only one habitable planet, and this planet will not compromise. But there's hope. Evidence is ample that it is possible to stay within the ecological bounds of one Earth. But it requires revolutionary change and active stewardship. And we need new mindsets, a global mindset. Hence the importance of global thinking. Because the issues are global and they are interconnected. And as a society, we all here, everybody, the global society as a whole, we have to make tough decisions simultaneously. Whew, and this is a daunting project. I mean, but it's also exciting because we are in this all together. We have a chance to transform the current paradigms. We can realize our innovative plans. We can do things differently. And there are already many successes, local successes. For example, local farmers in countries in Africa are planting trees to improve degraded land, fight climate change, and help alleviate poverty. Farmers' communities in India working together to use organic farming technologies to improve their health, their livelihoods, and the environment. Cities like Seattle, but have raised minimum wage to $15 an hour to reduce income inequality and empower its citizens. We are launching sharing platforms. We share goods, because really, do we all need a lawnmower? So these are examples of revolutionary changes through the through active communities working together, seeking for opportunities which protect the resilience of Earth. And the organization I work for, our task, is part of this movement. And to accomplish our mission of informing and empowering young people to think globally, so that they become effective global leaders, we work together with a variety of communities through our programs. We have developed a global thinking workshop, and we teach this course in high schools, the university. We are working together with students to write a 2100 global project about the state of the world, and we make recommendations. We are working together with experts in the fields, with other local nonprofits to organize an annual 2100 conference. So these are really powerful and valuable relationships with communities. And we would like to partner with you. Because faith communities have so much to contribute to the understanding of sustainable development. Within all large faith traditions, there is this real commitment to protect the earth. For example, the Dalai Lama said once in his teachings, "The world grows smaller and smaller, more and more interdependent. Today, more than ever before, life must be characterized by a sense of universal responsibility, not only nation to nation and human to human, but also human forms of life." Pope Francis gave his first comment on why the world's 1.2 billion Catholics should care about climate change. He said, "I don't know if it's all man's mate's fault, but the majority is. For most of the part, it is man who continuously slaps down nature." And religious communities attract large, close-knit groups of people who draw from values and norms within their faith. So I believe this is the perfect opportunity for us to work together to inform and empower people within the faith community to think globally, so that they become effective global leaders and so spark positive change on a global scale. So I have an idea how we can work together. Our task, we introduced Eco Friday, and this is a monthly event on global issues and alternative plans, so plans that will guide, hopefully, civilization through the 21st century and beyond. And at these events, it will bring together people to learn, to network, and take action on these pressing global issues. And I'd love to introduce an Eco Day in your community, because I think this is a really powerful way to reach a very large group of the population. So I'd love to explore the possibilities for collaborating with everyone here who is interested. Thank you for listening, and please get in touch.